I have no idea what kind of trouble I'm getting into today, but we're going to get into it. This is a wonderful parts caster. I'm not sure the significance of that, but maybe I'll ask later and find out. Because it's a bunch of parts, one of the issues is the neck needs some fret leveling and recrowning. It's all sort of inconsistent. But this is one of the reasons why I try to videotape all my repairs, even if it doesn't end up on YouTube, and let's just talk about that. Alrighty. The other concern was some sort of ground hum, which I cannot recreate on my bench. It's got a push-pull thing. If this splits that rear pickup, so there's a bit of single coil hum when you do that, but when I cannot make it have a ground fault. So I can only assume that it's something else in the food chain at the other end, and this is not the first time I've witnessed this sort of thing. So it's like right now, there's constant nudity between the strings and the plate. I don't really want to open this up and look in it. I'll shake the guitar around, I'll wiggle the cable, I'll move the knobs, but I can't make it fill. So that was a pretty easy job. But like I said, the reason I like to try and videotape everything, even if it doesn't end up on the YouTubes, is to just say, hey, it was fine here. Or the other thing is, like, when I open this up and then I'm it and it all falls apart in my hands, that's the other reason. So that's why I'm not opening it up. I can't make it not do what it's supposed to do. Everything works. What's that doing? Okay, some sort of series parallel, I guess, between both pickups. It does something there too, so it's a different tone. Clicks in a different tone capacitor. That definitely, I can even demonstrate that that's both coils, and then we got one coil. Nothing, and then both coils. So I'm guessing they're only using one side of this little switch. It just reverts back to its normal self. Something like that. I don't want to look. It all works. Okay, let's get the strings loosened off, and I did check to make sure the truss rod works, so we'll be able to correct all the fret noise. Oh, here, I'll show you why we hate it. Just because I can. It's like, no, we don't like that kind at all. So we're going to fix all that. Stay tuned. Fret leveling and crowning is really a lot of fun the first five or six times you do it. After that, it sort of just becomes a job. And in order to not want to go hang yourself in the shed, we sort of want to make that job go as quickly as possible. Like I said, it's fun the first few times. It's really fun the first few times doing it the old style with a three-sided file and, oh, you know, especially if you have nothing else to do. So I think the wood looks very straight there. So what's going on with the frets? Let's have a quick look this way. It's all the way around in here. You can actually see them humping up. Not getting any rocking. It just doesn't look right.
the radius is 9.5, and I have that radius block. I don't really use the beam too much anymore unless I'm dealing with something that has a compound radius. And then the beam, the flat beam, will just follow the existing radius. So depending on how much of it you do, right, how much money you want to spend on tools. I know I'm going to buy every tool I can order online. Every guitar repair tool is on demand. And then I'm going to do my first setup.
Well, we're all taped off and colored blue, and gently take the block one direction towards the nut. Mm-hmm.
You get the idea, till the blue goes away. We have a beautiful set of flat, useless frets. Make them all blue again. And then we're gonna get the crowning file and make them do what they're supposed to do again. I go with the very expensive diamond version, but for many years, I used that, which is just as effective. It's just not as nice. So when you use this one to crown, you have a lot more work to do to make the frets smooth and beautiful again. Whereas with the diamond, it also makes very quick work because that's the file is one directional, right? This works in two directions. So. Also, the angled handle, right, that, you want something like that. What have I got over here? Something else that I hate, which doesn't work very well at all. I don't even know why I have it, but I do. Okay, this is, we know whose version, and this is diamond as well, but I believe the diamonds fell off it the first time I used it. There's nothing left on that. And the other thing too is because it has no angle on certain guitars where the body is hooked on to the neck and you can't take it off, this is really in the way of everything and doesn't work very good. Well, it doesn't. I don't even know why I'm keeping it. Like I said, I just looked at it and all the diamonds have fallen off it. Anyway, let's crown them up. And this does two grits, 150, and then it'll flip over to 300. And then I will finish the job after that with some other tools. So we got crowns. In days gone by, I used to go through all the various grits of sandpaper and take all the abrasions out. But things do get better, and for two reasons. Wait a minute, I got new ones. Whoa, they're way over here. Thing. Come on out. Oh, look, and somebody likes me all at once. Hang on, I'll be right back. Oh yeah, back to it. Excuse me. Hoskell Polishing is sending a rubber eraser set. I always wanted these, but they were too expensive. Nobody here in Canada had them. But now my friends at Solo Guitars carry them, and they're quite economical. I will say they are definitely more economical than sandpaper and last longer. So we're going to go through all the grits with these guys, get rid of all the abrasions, and then maybe a little bit of metal polish, and we're out of here. Just like that. Even with just the very first grit, you can see we're doing good work. Well, I'm going to finish up with some metal polish, and I confess this is actually cymbal polish. But some guys do the high speed thing. And when you put metal polish on one of those little wheels and it gets all black like that, well, it's over. When you go, it doesn't really do anything that I can see that I can't do better by hand. And then, you know, I guess if you wanted to take something high speed and go at it, it just doesn't last very long. That's the problem. You know, that's it. These look fantastic for the next 3 days, and then they'll start to tarnish again. So it's like, but they're going to be clean today. Hey, well, that's that. Get the tape off it and put it back together, set it up, and once again double check that I cannot find an electronic fault with this, and I'm actually going to plug it into my Vox amp and double check on two different setups. Okay, I got my bench amp, which usually, I mean, it's pretty crappy, and there's, you know, I got lighting around, which I don't think affects things. And I can't hear any noises out of that that it shouldn't be making. Oh, here's one to remember, because I lived this once, okay? It'll make you laugh. Made me laugh after I figured out what the hell was going on. I installed a pickup in a Telecaster. Okay. Single coil pickup, right? Which we know can be noisy. I had it on my bench here. And I had, this is good. It took me a minute to figure out what the hell was going on. I have my soldering iron here on the bench, like that. And I soldered it in place, and then I plugged it in the amp, and I turned up the volume, and it was really, really making a lot of hum. Like, 60 cycle hum. And I, for the life of me, checked everything. Wait, what tells me? Oh, the transformer in the soldering iron power supply was in proximity to the single coil pickup, and it was a head scratcher for about 5 minutes until I went, oh, you idiot. Strings are on it, we're tuned up, we'll set the truss rod, 0.012. Give or take 0.002. It's up to you. It depends how heavy your hatchet hand is. So right now we need to tighten this a little bit, and then we'll set the string height and floor mount the intonation and all that other great stuff. Now that that's set, I'm pretty sure I can get the string action down to something usable, because I didn't touch this, but it's not right. What are we sitting at? 17th fret. What we want would be what James Burton would play, which would be 4/64s. Right now, this isn't bad. It's sitting at 5, so at least it's within the realms. You could have it at 5, but all the strings have to be at 5, not just one of them. See a lot of that. That's great. That one's going to come up a hair. Like I said, I didn't touch these, so they were all set different. That's good. That one's good. The B string is unbelievably too high. Still, wow. That's going to be great. And wow, the high E string is, I don't know what they were thinking. That's better. That's good. That's good. I love it. I love it. Still could come down a little hair. That's it. Let's retune. And set the intonation. Oh, set the pickup height. There's not much we can do on this humbucker. I could take the pickup off and see what it does, but I think it does what it does. And this one actually could get moved up and down a little bit, I believe. Seems pretty good. It's weird, when the guitar lays flat, it looks like it's cockeyed in the hole, but it ain't. Okay, intonation time, and then double check that electronic complaint again, I guess. Well, folks, that's the most noise I can get out of it when I move it around on my bench towards the light with that back rear pickup in single mode, right? That's quiet. I'm sorry, there is no ground noise. Well, sounds okay to me. Let's all check all the... The G string was really bad. Just like a needle right in your eye. Right? Just like a knitting needle right in your eye. Okay, I quit this kind. Peel off the strings. And, cut off the strings, I mean. And, get out of here. All the great links to things are below. Once again, this is a good example of why I try to document every repair. Once again, I'll jump around with this, maybe do a Pete Townsend or two. I mean, I can make it have a hum if that's what you're after. I could fake it, right? Oh, I needed a tire rewiring, and oh my God, it was hours of it. Nothing wrong with it that I can find. So I gotta stick to that story. Yeah, in the description below are all the great links to things. Special shout out to all my patrons, especially. You keep me going. Subscribers, Facebook group, you can join it. I haven't had to kick anybody out yet for a while. I don't kick anybody out, I just mute you if you're silly. I don't care if you're silly, just don't post any shitty memes. It was funny, somebody posted a shitty meme on the Facebook group, and I just sort of laughed when I saw it, because on 8 other different feeds of friends and people, and I had seen it 8 times by the time you posted it. That's why I hate those fucking things, because they just go around like a bad smell. Right? That's all I got to say. Anyway, folks, thanks for hanging out. Be good to each other. Cheers.